They swept down from the mountains like a torrent and roared over the land. Half man they seemed, half beast. As wild as the hills they emerged from. In battle, none were more reckless, none more fearless. So terrible did they appear that their foes might turn and run before a blow was struck. They fought for nothing less than victory and mocked death itself. BC, a Celtic army marches to battle. A hunger for land, a craving for booty, pushes them on mile after mile. No obstacle, natural or human, hinders the wild men of Western Europe. Their enemy, the small young state called Rome, has never met such a foe. Much later, the historian Livy would record their coming with alarm. Too late for his countrymen.
A strange foe of whose power Rome knew nothing was on the march from the Atlantic Ocean and the farthest shores of the world. They flamed into the uncontrollable anger characteristic of their race and set forward with terrible speed on the path to Rome.
The Celts' exploits would be handed down by their victims, the Romans. They left no records of their own. Of their lives before, little is known. But by the 4th century BC, Europe was covered by a mosaic of Celtic tribes. Loosely joined by language, custom, and belief, the clans came to blows with one another over land, or wealth, or simply pride. Throughout the countryside, poor families tilled the soil on behalf of a nobleman. In return for a share of their harvest, they received the protection of his sword. Each Celtic tribe was led by a king and his chieftains, yet they could make no decision without the assembly of nobles, the men who held power, since they were the men who fought. In peacetime, they quarreled and dueled among themselves without cease. In time of war, they were invincible. At the end of the 4th century BC, a group of such men was called upon to gather their goods and their families and head south to Italy. There they would make new homes.
The king, wishing to relieve his kingdom of the burdensome excess of the population, announced his intention of sending his two nephews, both of them adventurous young men, out into the world to find such new homes as the gods by signs from heaven might point the way to.
There were plenty of adventurous young men to make the journey. From childhood, the sons of noblemen were taught the ways of war.
Fathers do not allow their sons to approach them openly until they have grown to an age when they can bear the burden of military service.
The king's nephews had grown up with swords and spears and shields. Together, the youths of the tribe had trained and hunted, feasted and drunk. Now, together, they would fight.
They set out with a vast host, some mounted, some on foot, and reached the foot of the Alps. Those skyey peaks into another world. These they crossed. They defeated the Etruscans and founded the town of Mediolanum.
Mediolanum, later to be called Milan, was one of many settlements carved out of the land of the Etruscans. Boasting of their courage, feasting on glory, the Celts dared anyone to challenge them in their new homeland. The challenge went unanswered. In battle, the Celts feared no man. They trembled only before their gods. A superstitious people, tribes followed their own deities. Though Lu, god of the sun, was worshipped by all. For a Celt, there was no hell, simply death and certain rebirth in a glorious afterlife. To a warrior who believed he would rise from his grave like the phoenix, death held no terror. The unfortunate Etruscans, fearful of their own mortality at the hands of the Celts, sought help from a neighbor to the south, a small city-state named Rome. The Romans sent north an army several thousand strong, confident they could expel the invader.
The Roman army had covered hardly 11 miles before it met the invaders, where the River Alia descends in a deep gully from the hills. The ground in front and on both sides was already swarming with enemy soldiers.
The Celts dressed in brightly colored tunics and checkered cloaks. Round their necks, they wore richly patterned torques. On their bodies, armbands, rings, jewels. As artists, these pagans were unequaled. Their ornate designs would reappear in another age, on the pages of the Gospels. The superstitious transformed into the sacred. Most warriors entered battle armed with only a spear and a shield. Some spearheads measured up to 20 inches in length. Others had undulating blades to mangle flesh. A nobleman's greatest weapon was his sword. Crafted by skilled blacksmiths, it was sturdily forged, not for thrusting, but slashing. Over time, swords were made even larger, up to 3 feet long. The finest swords, the privilege of the wealthiest men, were studded with precious stones to awe a foe from afar. Up close, their length and strength made a fearful impression. Before battle had even begun, the Celts could terrify their enemy into flight by their very appearance. A tall race of men, half naked, screaming and thrashing, their hair smeared with lime to stand up in spikes. They looked to the Romans like apparitions from the underworld. Even their helmets seemed the work of demons.
On their heads, they wear bronze helmets with large projecting figures, lending the appearance of enormous stature to the wearer.
Near the river Allia, the Celts gathered, more mob than army. Though motley in dress, they were united by their battle standards, animals of the forest and birds of prey. Whipping themselves into a frenzy, the warriors raised their terrible cries, broke into chants, and sang hymns of war. Now and then, a lone Celt would step forward and dare an opponent to fight. Above the din, the Romans heard the fearsome call of the Carnix, the Celtic battle horn.
The Roman commanders had taken no precautions. They drew up their line on as broad a front as they could, hoping not to be outflanked by the enemy's superior numbers. But the hope was vain.
Brennus, the Gallic chieftain, sized up the Roman army. Outnumbered, outflanked, unnerved, he ordered his men to attack. Every man threw himself into the fray.
Celts overran all the ground, in front and on both sides. At the first sound of the Gallic war cry, the legionaries fled in panic, so blinded to everything but saving their skins, hardly waiting even to see their strange enemy from the ends of the earth. None fell fighting. They were cut down from behind as they struggled to force a way to safety through the heaving mass of their fellow fugitives. Near the bank of the river, there was a dreadful slaughter. The whole left wing of the army had gone that way and had flung away their arms in a desperate hope of getting over. Many could not swim, and many others, in their exhausted state, were dragged underwater by the weight of their equipment and drowned. The Celts could hardly believe their eyes. For a while, they stood rooted to the spot, hardly realizing what had happened. Then, after a moment of fear lest the whole thing were a trap, they began to collect the arms and equipment of the dead.
As night fell, the Celts, victorious again, made camp. Nothing stood between them and the spoils of war. The rich city of Rome. The next day, the Celts stormed through the city gates. No Roman came out to resist them, the citizens had barricaded themselves on a hill within the capital. The wild men of Europe gazed dumbstruck at sights they had never beheld, high temples and grand buildings. Then they turned to plunder.
For the Romans, the full horror was almost too great to realize. Fate had made them spectators of the nightmare stage scene of their country's ruin.
The Celtic leader, Brennus, strode up to the senators at the capital and delivered an ultimatum. Pay a ransom and his men would leave. If not, the nightmare the Romans were living would seem merely a dream next to what would follow. The citizens brought gold and jewels to be tallied up, then complained at the way the booty was being weighed. Brennus is said to have added his heavy sword to the scales and declared, "Vae victis! Woe to the conquered!" When the tribute had been paid, the Celts were true to their word. They marched away. It was a mistake they would regret. Northern Italy now belonged to the Celts. A stream of invaders flowed into the vast plain of the Po River. The Romans themselves acknowledged the new inhabitants by calling the region Gallia Cisalpina, Gaul this side of the Alps. Within a century after the battle by the River Allia, the Celtic world reached its zenith. Those called Gauls by the Romans would leave their mark throughout Europe. Galicia in Spain, Galatia in Turkey, Galicia in Poland. After their defeat in 390 BC, the Romans set about restoring their city, building their army, and biding their time. In 225 BC, almost two centuries after their triumph at the River Allia, a huge Celtic army from all over northern Italy and beyond again threatened Rome. 50,000 infantry and 20,000 horses and chariots confronted a Roman force sent to stop them and swept it aside. 80 miles from the capital, the Celts halted. Two Roman legions, 8,000 strong, blocked their path. Satisfied with the booty they had plundered, the Celts this time turned back. This time, the Romans followed. Unknown to the Celts, another Roman army had appeared behind them, occupying a hill near the village of Telamon, and cutting off retreat. Beset on two sides, the Celts deployed back to back and prepared to fight in both directions.
The Romans were, on the one hand, encouraged by having caught the enemy between their two armies. But on the other hand, they were terrified by the fine order of the Celtic host and the dreadful din. Very terrifying, too, were the appearance and the gestures of the warriors in front.
The battle was as fierce as the Celts themselves, but this day, reckless bravery and hard steel would meet their match. When the enemies first clashed 2 centuries before, the Romans had carried small, round shields that proved useless against the great slashing swords. Now, each Roman was protected by a shield almost as long as his body. The Romans had learned something more. How to stop the Celts' wild charges. The answer was the javelin. Against the lightly armored Celts, this missile proved deadly. The Celts who survived the barrage were shoved back by the large shields of the Romans. Herded together, the Celts had no room to swing their long swords. From behind a wall of shields, the Romans thrust their newest weapon, a short blade, into naked flesh.
The main body of Celts met the enemy and kept up a stubborn hand-to-hand combat. For though being almost cut to pieces, they held their ground, equal to their foe in courage and inferior only in their weapons.
The Romans recorded that 10,000 Celts were captured, 40,000 were killed. The wild men of Europe had been broken.
This success encouraged the Romans to hope they would be able to entirely expel the Celts from the plain of the Po. A war which, if we look to the desperation and the daring of the combatants, and the numbers who took part and perished in battle, is second to no war in history.
In the next century, Rome grew only stronger as the land of the Celts shrank. Disunited, outfought, the Celtic tribes, one by one, were overwhelmed. By the end of the first century AD, the Celts had been driven from Italy, from Gaul, even from England. The tribes who once held Rome in their grip were pushed back to the place they had come from. The lands described by the Roman historian Livy, the farthest shores of the world.